Hi everyone, this video is to explain the action potential, and we're just going to talk about how an action potential is initially created. If you want to know about the quantitative basis of understanding the action potential using the Nernst and Goldman equations, please watch my other video about that. Also, there's another video that shows how action potentials are transmitted down the axon that follows on this one. To begin, you have to understand that action potentials occur primarily in the axons of neurons. So if you don't know the anatomy of a neuron, study it. It's very simple. And the axon is the output part of a neuron whose job it is to carry an electrical signal, like an electrical wire, over a long distance, up to 1 meter in a person and even longer in larger animals. Okay. So in order to create an action potential, we're creating an electrical change. In order to create an electrical change, we have to get charged particles to move, right? That's just logical. How can we get charged particles to move somewhere? Well, by putting them in a position where they're not at equilibrium, by taking them away from equilibrium. And the way that that is done is using a protein that you're probably already familiar with, the sodium-potassium pump. So this is a protein that is an ATPase. It hydrolyzes ATP, uses up energy, cellular energy, in order to move these two ions, sodium or Na and potassium or K, uphill. That is, you're moving them, you're accumulating them, you're moving them away from equilibrium and creating huge concentration gradients. So if you look at the colors in this picture, the yellow circles are meant to represent sodium and the purple diamonds to represent potassium. And you can see that these are very unequally distributed across the cell membrane with typically more than 10 times as much sodium on the outside of the cell membrane as the inside, and the reverse for potassium. So the pump creates a situation in which sodium and potassium are far from their equilibrium. And that means that if we create brief moments where they're allowed to move toward equilibrium, they will do so very quickly, creating a huge electrical change in that cell, and that's exactly what we want. So the only way we can get an action potential is because we've created these huge concentration gradients with the sodium-potassium pump. Okay, so in our axon here, at rest, we have three channels. Two of them are closed, and I'll talk about those in a minute. But one of them is open, and that is the potassium leak channel. And they're just called leak channels because they're open all the time. They're not gated. That is, they're always in one state, the open state that allows potassium to pass through them. Any channel is agnostic with regards to direction. That is, the channel doesn't know or care which way the ion is moving into or out of the cell. If we are potassium, we have a situation where there's 10 times as much potassium inside the cell as outside. And that creates a concentration gradient that pulls potassium out of the cell. However, the inside of the cell is negatively charged because of this movement of potassium. That is, as potassium leaves the cell, it makes the inside of the cell negative. And that negative charge then, of course, begins to draw potassium back in, or rather make it less favorable for potassium to move out. So potassium is a little bit conflicted in terms of which way it wants to move, and that's why this picture shows potassium moving both ways into and out of the cell. The predominant movement is outward, and that movement makes the inside of the cell negative. That's the thing that makes the inside of the cell negative, which we say creates the voltage or resting membrane potential of that cell. Depending on the cell type, the number usually given is minus 65 to minus 70 millivolts. So that means the inside of the cell is negative relative to the outside, and that the difference in magnitude is about 65 or 70 millivolts in size. Okay, so the inside of the cell is negatively charged because of this continuous leak of a positively charged ion out. Meanwhile, we have these two channels that are much more abundant than these leak channels, so much more important in a way. But those are closed at rest, all right? They're voltage gated, which means in order to open them, we need to have some degree of depolarization. That is, the cell is polarized in the sense that the inside is negatively charged relative to the outside. If it became a little bit less polarized, or if this number minus 65 became a little bit closer to zero, these would open. Often the value given is about minus 55 millivolts for these channels to open. That varies a little bit by cell type and animal, but that's a good number to keep in mind. So here we are in our axon, right? Now remember, neurons are connected to other neurons. So this neuron is receiving input either from other neurons, most typically the ones in your brain, or if it's a sensory neuron, it's receiving input from environmental signals outside the body, such as light and sound and so on, or signals within the body, such as changes in blood pressure and so on. So these are being detected by that sensory neuron, or the neuron is receiving signals from other neurons, and those signals create some positive charge in that cell. You get movement of positive charge into the axon. And that positive charge takes this value of minus 65 or 70 up just a little bit. It depolarizes the cell just enough to open these voltage-gated channels. So voltage is just the charge difference across the membrane, the membrane potential. And as that membrane potential becomes a little bit smaller in magnitude, closer to zero, this number is not as big, as we get more positive, these open, and they both open at roughly the same value, but the potassium channels are like old creaky doors, opening really slowly, whereas the sodium channels snap open. So functionally, we can say that the sodium channels open first, that is, they are completely open first. Okay? So at rest, we have much more movement of potassium across the membrane than sodium because we have more permeability. That's what this P is. More permeability, that is, more ability for potassium to cross the membrane than sodium. However, as soon as these voltage-gated sodium channels change, that reverses. We now have much more ability for sodium to cross the membrane than potassium because there are only a few leak channels, but there are many, many voltage-gated sodium channels. So now the sodium channels are open. Sodium is going to rush into the cell because, number one, there's more than 10 times as much sodium outside the cell membrane as inside, so the sodium's going to rush in down its concentration gradient. Further, the inside of the cell is negatively charged, at least minus 55 at the beginning of this movement, and potassium is a positively charged ion, so that further creates a strong electrochemical gradient drawing sodium into the cell. Sodium comes in and in. Now, at some point, so much comes in that the cell becomes positively charged from all this sodium movement, okay? As the sodium comes in and makes the inside of the cell more positively charged, sodium's less drawn into the cell. That is, its concentration gradient is still drawing it in. The action potential has no functional impact on the concentration gradient, like spitting in the ocean. This is a permanent state of the cell, these concentration gradients. But the charge, now it's positively charged inside the cell, that is repelling, that begins to repel sodium. At some point, these two are equal and opposite. You still have the concentration gradient drawing sodium into the cell, but the electrical gradient is equal and opposite, repelling sodium out of that cell. And the point of those two balance, we say, is sodium's equilibrium potential, and it's marked on this as ENA, E sub NA, the equilibrium potential for sodium. At that point, there's no net movement of sodium across the cell. And around the same time, these sodium channels are no longer open. So either from reaching equilibrium or from the sodium channels no longer being open, we have no more movement of sodium after a period of time. But meanwhile, we've created a huge change, a very steep change in voltage because of the fast movement of sodium into the cell. And now we have a very positively charged cell. Okay, so what happens now is that sodium channels inactivate. Now, this sounds like being closed, but it's, I would say, worse. It's different in that they're not just closed, because a closed channel could be open, but they're inactivated. They can't be opened. It's a little bit the difference between a closed door and a locked door. These channels cannot be reopened, and this is important because it prevents action potentials from adding up and piggybacking on each other. That's impossible. Each action potential is an all-or-none event, and that's because these sodium channels have a period of time in which they cannot be reopened. Okay, So the sodium channels are inactivated. Meanwhile, the voltage-gated potassium channels are fully open. And you'll notice this arrow only shows potassium leaving because we're now in a completely different state than we were at rest. We still have the huge concentration gradient of potassium pushing potassium out of the cell. But now we also have a big charge gradient pushing potassium out of the cell because now the inside of the cell is positively charged. Before it was negatively charged, which created a conflict for potassium, but now both forces, electrical and chemical, are pushing it out of the cell. So there's a tremendously fast movement of potassium out of the cell. We return all the way down to our resting value and even lower because potassium will reach its equilibrium where charge and concentration balance only below the original resting value. And at this point here, the graph shows we have much more permeability for potassium than sodium. In fact, the only open channels here are for potassium and the sodium channels are inactivated. Finally, those sodium channels are now closed, so the door is closed but not locked. The sodium channels could be reopened again. The potassium channels are still open, but we flatten out here. Why do we flatten out? Because we're at equilibrium. Potassium doesn't want the cell to be any more negative than it is, so it's flattened out. And the last step then is to return to the resting state where those voltage-gated potassium channels are closed, and we just have the leak channel open. Sometimes people will tell you that this return from the hyperpolarized state down here to the resting state is because of the sodium-potassium pumps or some lies like that, but that's not true at all. The reason why we return to this initial value is because that's the value that's created by the rate of potassium movement through potassium leak channels. If potassium can leave as fast as it wants, as on the previous slide, it can make the cell more negative. But at rest, only a few potassium channels are open, and the rate of that movement of potassium out of the cell is just fast enough to make the inside of the cell negatively charged. Now, what we have just done is create a fast electrical change, a big electrical change, but a local electrical change. So in order to do what neurons are evolved to do, we have to be able to take this show on the road to get this action potential down the axon, and that will be the topic of the next video. See you there.